Okay, so I'd like to welcome everybody to the latest installment of the Iowa OER webinar series. These are sort of semi-regular information sessions that we hold for people working on various types of open projects, both in the state of Iowa and beyond. And so if anybody has topics of interest, anybody on the call that they'd like to see in the future for these webinars, you can always feel free to contact us through the Iowa OER Google group. And I'll paste in some links in just a moment to that Google group, as well as our group's website and our YouTube channel too, so you can see archives of past webinars. My name is Mariah Burnett, and I'm the Scholarly Communications Librarian at the University of Iowa. And I'm joined today by Marco Seiferle-Valencia, who's the Open Education Librarian at the University of Idaho. And he'll be giving a presentation called Alternative Open Ontologies, Open Education in El Museo Indigenista, is that right? Sorry. No, it's Indigenista. Sorry, I practiced, but my Spanish is pretty rusty. But today's topic is one that really has broad applicability, I think, outside of the state of Iowa. And we're really pleased today to be joined by members from across the US and even perhaps beyond today. And I'd also like to thank Abby Elder, Iowa State University's Open Education and Scholarly Communications Librarian, for helping to arrange today's guest. And in fact, our guest today and Abby have recently authored an OER starter kit for program managers, which is kind of an update to Abby's OER starter kit, I believe. And hopefully some of you were able to catch their presentation last week at Open Ed. So today, Marco will be discussing how emerging alternative ontologies of open create space for a broader historicizing of the open movement. He'll also discuss how ideas emerging in Indigenous open resonate with earlier interventions taken by BIPOC educators to create free and socially just materials. Using Dr. Lucy Cruz Gayek's El Museo Indigenista as a case study, Seiferle-Valencia will explore how previously unconnected educational activism resonates and rings with many core concepts and themes emerging in open today, especially in Indigenous open. So we'll keep our microphones muted during the presentation. But if you have any questions, you can feel free to put them in the chat. And you know, when the time is good, then we'll sort of ask those questions as they come up. But then at the end, we're hoping to save a good chunk of time for questions and discussion. So feel free to come at us with your questions after the presentation. So I do want to remind everybody that this whole session is being recorded for sharing out afterwards. And again, I'll post the link to the archives in the chat. So I will now turn it over to Marco.
Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And just thank you again for the opportunity to be here. And special thank you to Abby for helping to arrange this visit with you all today. So I'm going to go ahead and start my screen share here. And we'll hope that that goes as planned, because it's always a little roll of the dice. I'm going to do this a little bit different, where I don't actually go into the screen share mode right off the bat. Or maybe I will, but we have a bunch of tabs we're going to look at later when we look at this archive. So we'll see how this goes, kind of toggling back and forth. But this is my presentation today, Alternative Open Ontologies, Open Education, and El Museo Indigenista. I'm Marco Seiferle-Valencia. I'm the Open Education Librarian at the University of Idaho and a co-creator of the Chicana Por Mi Raza Digital Memory Collective, which is the sort of two intersections that are coming together for me today. I want to just draw your attention to this link down in the lower right corner of my screen and hopefully yours. It's bit.ly/lcg-22. If you go there, you can follow along with this presentation. Part of my sort of feminist research and scholarly practice in open is trying to cite a lot of other folks who have influenced me. So there's a lot of links throughout this presentation that I'm going to refer to. So that's part of what that link's there for, and it should live on after this presentation as well. Okay, so this is me, Marco Seiferle-Valencia, Open Education Librarian and co-creator of Chicana Por Mi Raza Digital Memory Collective. Those are my professional titles. Those titles are important to me, and especially Chicana Por Mi Raza. That's a title I've held for more than 10 years now. But other titles that are important to me are a brown native Chicano person, a transgender person, a disabled person. And so I come from an intersection of a lot of different identities, and I actually started Chicana Por Mi Raza pre-transition. And so I didn't even know I was transgender when I started working on Chicana Por Mi Raza. And it's really partly the liberatory praxis of that project that helped me to sort of wake up to myself, so to speak. So I always like to also start with something that people are a little bit more used to now, which is a land and place acknowledgement. I'm going to start with the one that the University of Idaho gives us to share. So U of I Moscow is located on the homelands of the Nimiipuu, the Palouse, and the Coeur d'Alene tribes. We extend gratitude to the indigenous people that call this place home since time immemorial. U of I recognizes that it's our academic responsibility to build relationships with the indigenous people to ensure integrity of tribal voices. So a lot of you have probably seen a land acknowledgement like this from your university or institution. And these land acknowledgements are great for helping people to understand the context that they're in and whose land they might be on. Some academics, including me, have criticisms of land and place acknowledgements from the perspective of, it's kind of like, you know, if I steal your car and then say, your car is beautiful, like you still don't have a car, right? And there's still an injustice that has happened. So I've been experimenting and talking with my partner who works in public health promotion, you know, how do we go past this? And so I've been experimenting with this idea. For anyone here who happened to see an open ed presentation with me last week, you will have seen the same introduction where I suggest, you know, maybe check out some of these organizations that you can donate either time or money to and think about what making reparations means in this context, especially if you are a non-Indigenous person and or someone who's directly benefited from settler colonization. And sometimes you can be both, right? I am someone who is both Chicano native and also from recent settlers and settlers who came over on the pilgrim, you know, pilgrims basically. And so it's like I have literally all these identities in play. And so I'm always trying to think about how do we push what reparation means and acknowledgement means and go past just basic acknowledgement. This ethos here also informs what we're going to talk about, which is basically this feminist praxis of trying to do work in the right way. And so in Indigenous belief, we are always thinking about how do we do things in a way that is right, not just for me, but for the many generations coming after me, and also that honors the people who came before me and also addresses the things that they need to address, right? I personally am also a Buddhist, and so interesting intersections there between all those things. Okay, but we're not talking about philosophy and religion today. Somewhat unfortunately, that'll be my next open thing perhaps. But today we're going to talk about these conventional and open ontologies that we're used to and how we can trouble them a bit. So if we were all together in a room, I might say, raise your hand if you've ever seen a conventional history of open that looks like this. The open educational resources movement is 15 years old. This IFSE reviews OER's history, its extraordinary growth, and its place in education from the perspective of some folks who worked at the Hewlett Foundation. I should also acknowledge here, this is by TJ Bliss and co-author Smith. TJ is actually my like great, great, great grandpa boss at the University of Idaho because he's at the State Board of Education. And so I don't mean to be calling these authors out specifically. I partly picked this particular citation because it is a pretty well-cited source for a history of open. And so it's less about any one specific author and more about the way the movement itself has defined itself. So he goes on to then say this origins of open starts with this National Science Foundation grant, and eventually in 1998, the creation of open and OER as a methodology and a praxis by David Wiley. So if you've seen a history like this before, you know, I think on the one hand, in a very literal way, you can say, like, I understand this is where some of these terms and specific practices originate. But when you have a feminist educational background, it's hard to see how this is where an open movement starts. And so right from the start of me coming into this discipline, I've been curious about who's missing from sort of the ontologies. Just as a side note, I really wanted to include a Miley Cyrus gif of her saying, "What does it mean?" Which, if anyone knows, okay, great. Thank you, Jessica. Thank you, my number one VIP crowd participant, for getting my meme reference. Because I literally put ontologies in the title of this, and I was like, maybe I'm not even using this word correctly. So this is the way that I'm intending this, right? Ontologies is the set of concepts within a domain and basically how we understand the history of it and what comprises it. And when we situate open as having an ontology that looks like the one I just showed you, we kind of leave out a lot of people that I personally think should be included. And indeed, a lot of other scholars are also arguing should be included as well. And so I do have a link in the slide deck if you're curious for the citation on this and you want to read more about ontologies yourself and let me know what you think about what your version of an open ontology is. Okay, so if we go forward here instead of back, it's clicking on that link for us. We'll click out of there. So by specifically and intentionally including women of color educational praxis into our open discourse, we help expand and situate open as a movement in education, which itself has always contained a socially justice-oriented praxis led by Black Indigenous people of color. Right. So when we truly understand education as a discipline and a history in its own right, to me, it makes sense to think of open as a logical extension, a sort of technologically informed extension of a lot of things that had already started. In the open kind of scholarship right now, we have a lot of open praxis that is focused more on what we might call the DEI potentials. And this includes me and some of my previous scholarship talking about how in a workplace or a school setting, we can use open to achieve different goals that we have in a sort of institutional context like diversity, equity, and inclusion. Something that's always kind of troubled me about this, though, is that DEI is itself a sort of corporatized concept. And so I haven't done the most research into this, but it, you know, DEI emerged in the 1960s as an intervention into racist workplaces after the federal end of segregation. And was a sort of like, how do we systematically fix what is systematically screwed up in this country effectively, right? And it's like, well, that's a pretty tall order. Like, just don't be racist at work. Like, how are you going to do that? You have to ask people to not be racist all the time. People have to take up an anti-racist praxis. And there's a lot of obstacles to why people don't do that, or why they're only engaged with it to a certain point. So I would say DEI and radical liberatory praxis are not one and the same, but they do have similarities, and you might think of them as being on a spectrum or one informing the other. Some of the really great DEI scholarship that I saw just recently includes this wonderful slide, which was in a presentation. I'm going to pull this up so I can get the citation here for these folks. This is one of our case study co-authors in the textbook we mentioned earlier. James Glappa, Gross Clog, Una Dolly, and Jamie Thomas gave this wonderful presentation. There was a ton of presentations at Open Education this year that were focused on DEI. So this is just, you know, one of the ones that I've happened to watch enough to process enough to cite here. So if you're following along online, you can click this and watch this presentation. Some other scholars that you definitely want to know about if you're interested in this is Professor Jasmine Roberts' crew, Dr. Camille Gentles-Pert, who gave an amazing keynote closing at Open Ed, Regina Gong, and other BIPOC scholars who are building scholarship that emphasize social justice, self-representation, and the deep roots in BIPOC liberatory theory and praxis of open education. I never claim to know everything there is to know here on these topics, and I am especially cognizant that I am not Black, so I do not mean to be speaking about Black feminism for Black feminists. But in my work on Chicana Parmidrasa, which is itself a BIPOC archive, there's so much overlap between Black and Brown feminisms and educational praxis that to me, I'm so happy to see other folks who are in positional identities and able to speak on this really impactfully. So check out these keynotes. These are just a couple that I pulled out recently. Professor Roberts' crew has so many, it's hard to even know which one to select. Just watch everything that you can find on her YouTube, and you're going to have such a much better perspective on open education and our social justice potentials and where we need to go. I also want to make sure to acknowledge Kayla Larson, who is a librarian at UBC. I'm sorry, Kayla, that I don't have your full title on here. She's also an editor on a text that I'm working on, which is where this presentation is a chapter that we're going to be publishing this research that I'm talking about here. It's forthcoming. I have the details of that at the end of this. She created the six R's of Indigenous OER, so a reimagining OER to honor Indigenous knowledge and sovereignty. So I'm going to actually show you those six R's a little bit later, but this is a presentation she just did earlier this year, and I just really liked it. It just talked about what is a sort of approach to OER that takes what has worked in sort of traditional open, I guess you might say, and then also says, how do we indigenize this and make this more impactful and effective for Indigenous people and also represent Indigenous protocols? So this really relates to a lot of the stuff I'm going to talk about in our work on Chicana Parmidrasa, but I just want to acknowledge these colleagues as people who are inspirations to me, and folks that if you want to know more, you should check them out and definitely follow these threads further down the line. My presentation today continues threads of scholarship I shared in 2020 that cited Black feminist thinkers like bell hooks and Regina Austin as discussing concepts and core values related to open several decades before our conventional histories of open began. You can check those out in the form of this open ed presentation, which I gave in 2020, and this article, which is It's Not Just About the Cost, Academic Libraries and Intentionally Engaged OER for Social Justice. Just FYI, this is the hot link to the GitHub with the open version. So you do not need a scholar or a subscription to a scholarship to the Library Trends Journal. You can just log in and get this right there. It's just available for you free on the web. Okay, so let's just keep diving in here. What is Chicana Por Madrasa? Chicana Por Madrasa is a phrase that means Chicana for my people. And the kind of concept with this here is that waking up to who you are, including the specifics of your racial and ethnic identity, is something that benefits you, the people you belong to, and everyone else. This is actually like a slogan that came out of some materials in the archive that then was adapted by Linda Garcia Merchant and Maria Cotera, who are my two other co-creators on this project. So Chicana Por Madrasa is a digital archive, a liberatory praxis, a community space. You can view it in a couple of ways. So this is our publicly facing website. If anyone says it looks like this website's from 2013, you're right, it is. I'm working on the new one. Got a lot of things on the tenure track. But basically, this is a site that we built to show some of our public facing content. And I always refer to this as sort of our museum. This is our front facing curated tip of the iceberg. We have a whole archive that's actually now, fortunately, on a solid institutional repository at the University of Texas. And this is our actual whole data set of Chicana Por Madrasa. So this website represents maybe a tenth of the holdings, a fifth of the holdings. Really what it shows is student created and curated content. So this is one of our most recent projects, which highlights Dr. Osa Hidalgo de la Riva, or Dr. Eagle Bear, a queer Chicanx filmmaker and visual artist who has been creating and collaborating across the world with a focus on the Southwest since the mid 1960s. This was actually created in partnership, I believe, with the University of New Mexico. And so at this point we've partnered with probably about a dozen different institutions where they actually engage with our process and do this as part of a class. And so they'll collect oral histories, they will scan and collect the items, they will create the metadata, they will upload it to this website, and then they will try to assemble all of this into a history that the person works to approve, ideally if she's still alive or her descendants. We have done this with about 125 women and other non-binary people. We have collected oral histories and archives whenever available and whenever people will share with us, but we only do digital collection. So we scan things and we preserve them that way, but we don't take people's stuff. The other thing about our archive is we have a lot of stuff from some really big names in Chicana studies, like Sherry Moraga comes to mind. And we have a lot of things in her archive that are just never going to be public facing, but might be available on a sort of case by case researcher approach. So this website, like I said, I built it in 2013. We partly built it to have a way to engage students with this project, frankly, to have a way to have an unfunded project that did have access to volunteer student labor and to say, how could we take this interest that these students had in the archive and use what they were doing in assignments to also create something durable that lived online and helped explore this history. So this is our website, kind of just sort of clicked you through as I narrate that. I said we're a digital archive, a liberatory praxis, and a community space. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that liberatory praxis in a little bit, but what I want to get to right now is, are we an open resource? And in some ways, I would say no. We don't use Creative Commons licenses, and I don't think we would. I mean, we might on certain educational materials, but we actually really embrace traditional copyright protections for our holdings. And that's because we have very specific memorandums of understandings between Chicana Por Madrasa, which is not even a 501c3. It's a collective. It's an organization of people. And so we have an MOU, but we don't allow everyone or anyone access to the holdings. So if you want to come in and do research on the project, we use what I refer to as a kind of co-op model, meaning you have to actually contribute something back to come in and take something out of the archive. So this kind of gets away from the kind of extraction that we would frequently see, especially in BIPOC archives, where as sort of waves of interest from the settler imaginary come by, sometimes folks want to come and engage with these archives and extract a lot. We ask that people contribute something back. And frequently the contribution is something like a biography of a person that they've done a research on, a discussion of the particular event that they were researching, or the creation of some kind of data visualization, like a story map, a timeline, or really whatever. Truly people are able to sort of set what they want to do, but we do ask that they do something. Researchers need to form this collaborative versus extractive relationship, right? So one of the ways that I often think of open is, you know, it's out there and people can just get it and I can use it within the licensing as prescribed and I don't have to like create that relationship. But for us, that's part of our protocols and the way that we need to do things. We created what we call these Rescuache protocols. I'll go into what that word means in a moment. But what they are is basically a sort of description of how we do what we do. So our work is grounded in Chickenek's knowledge traditions and memory keeping. There is a lot of oral history just traditionally for Chickenek's people, Native people in general. I think that's part of the impact of colonization, right? Like many people in this archive would cite Mexican ancestors, Aztec ancestors. We'll actually talk about that a little bit with Lucy Cruz, who had incredible traditions of knowledge keeping and knowledge building that were then systemically destroyed during Spanish colonization. So this idea of having these histories that we need to keep alive against a sort of oppressive colonial system, that's been a reality for us for over 400 years. And so this is very much part of our sort of oral tradition practice, and also we have to do this for ourselves practice. We are collective and collaborative. We value relationships over digital tools. Self-determination is more important than being visible or assimilatable or even understandable. Sometimes we'll have people say, you shouldn't call it Chicana por mi raza because nobody knows what that means. It's like, well, you mean you don't know what it means and that it makes you uncomfortable that you don't know what it means. And to those people, I say, well, this is such a great opportunity to be able to sit with that sort of discomfort that might cause you. We value pedagogy and capacity building over ownership of knowledge. So those dozen or so projects that we've supported, we don't actually own what they've shared. We create space for them on our infrastructure, but they have their own MOUs with their own people. And we are just creating a space that hosts what they want to put up there or take down. We try to use the resources of the university while also decentering it as a site of power, building community knowledge and hubs and distributed knowledge of networks with what we've learned. So a lot of the work that I do in this project also involves telling other people who are interested in projects like this how to do it. Rescuache, I said I'd define that. This is a Mexican art practice of turning discarded items into something beautiful, making something exemplary or valuable with what others have deemed trash. Just as a kind of fun aside, some of our most engaged with collections and art from the community in Detroit actually had been discarded by archives at the University of Michigan, and we were able to grab them out of the dumpster and get those things digitized and have a great community show with it, which really shows just how out of touch sometimes the institution can be. Okay, so Lucy Cruz and El Museo Indigenista. For this one, I was going to try to put slides in here, and then I realized I actually don't want to do that because, like I said, we can't just share all this stuff openly. And so I wanted to be able to share this presentation. But for now, we're actually going to go into the archive and learn a little bit about Dr. Lucy Cruz. So Dr. Lucy Cruz, this is her here. She was a community historian in Southwest Detroit. She passed away in 2018. And one of the things that she did for about the past 25 years of her life was run a community museum. And unfortunately, we don't have the pictures of the museum, but we do have the materials that she put in it. And what she did was create materials herself, Find materials and other sources, including in textbooks in Mexico and South America, and compile all these things together into a curriculum. And she would then invite students of the local communities to come and actually tour the museum. And indeed, in Southwest Detroit, a lot of people don't know, it's called Mexican Town because there's just a predominantly Mexican neighborhood there. And the school system was still, you know, basically using a standard curriculum that didn't actually address the needs of those students. And so Dr. Cruz was one of the first people to graduate with a degree from Wayne State University in Chicano Boricua Studies, and I think the first Chicana to do so. And so she used that knowledge and her trips to Mexico and her connections, I don't know how she did this, to pull together all this different content. And so I'm just kind of clicking through this now. I'll highlight some of this stuff in a moment. But I want to read you this brief passage just kind of describing this museum. So the first of these earlier efforts to establish a Latinx museum was initiated in the 1980s when Dr. Lucy, a community expert on Mexican history and culture, and one of the first PhDs to graduate from Wayne State University's Center for Chicano Boricua Studies, opened her own museum, El Museo Indigenista. According to Dr. Elena Harada, Dr. Lucy's museum housed a massive personal collection of artifacts that included homemade models of the Aztec Empire, mannequins wearing regional Mexican costume, handcrafts of ceramic artwork from places she had traveled in Mexico, and all manner of collected material which she herself archived and displayed. Hundreds of school children and community members in Detroit passed through this humble setup by appointment only. Dr. Lucy ran the whole operation herself without government funds or much outside assistance so that she could maintain autonomy over the project. So Dr. Lucy has been one of my heroes ever since I heard about her in 2012 as a librarian at the University of Michigan. And she remains one of my heroes as I voyage into open education. And when I hear this, I hear feminism, and I also hear open education. I hear someone who saw the gaps in the curriculum and filled them herself. And I have to say that, you know, working through this archive and just doing this research has been so personally affirming to me. One of the things that's happened for me living here on the Palouse is I've learned traditional Nez Perce basket making from Leanne Campbell, who's, oh, you know, a nationally, internationally recognized Nez Perce basket maker. And so I've been lucky to learn this from her very directly. And it's also caused a lot of imposter syndrome and identity crisis as a person with a mestizo identity, a person with a mixed heritage of both white settlers and also sort of unknown Native heritage. And so looking through Lucy Cruz's archive and doing this research, I discovered this amazing entry about basketry and how people in the Mexican, you know, what we refer to now as Mexico, the Mexican Peninsula, but really the entire region had been basket makers since time immemorial, right? And I was able to share this with Leanne, my teacher, and we had this wonderful conversation about it. And it was so affirming to my identity. Similarly, I love this one. This is the Incas, and it's, I think this is lifted out of some coloring book somewhere. I truly do not know, and I don't even know how we would cite it or province it. But it shows a Peruvian guy planting potatoes. And I'm definitely going to use this in some of my instruction here in Idaho, right? Because when I work with these K through 12 classrooms, I'll say, what's something about Idaho? And these kids, mostly white kids, will say, oh, it's boring. It's just boring mayonnaise, white stuff like potatoes, right? And then I always blow their mind because I'm like, well, did you know where potatoes come from? Like, that's not a white thing. And to be able to have something like this, to be able to put in front of even younger children and have a visual depiction, it's just incredible. So this shows some of the materials that she put together. This is like something that she found somewhere and just got creative with copyright and pulled it in. This may well be the same, but she also created a lot of her own material. And she both created written material that was then in the archive, but she also basically used a newspaper column as a community education point. So she would just write all of these kind of like amazing histories, covering both more regional things, but also these like long form, let me just pull this one up, long form histories about Montezuma, Aztec life, Spanish conquistadores. Some of it's a little problematic to be honest, because it includes some of these complex mestizo veneration of colonial identities. And so it's fascinating to be able to read it, right? And so you can just see how she used whatever she had and whatever was available, which included her own knowledge, her own gathering of these resources, as well as, you know, like things here, she's actually creating, this is like a listing of types of instruments played in Latin America. And she includes, you know, a like the native name of it, and then sometimes like a Spanish name of it when possible. So again, just this kind of representation of indigenous identity, helping Mexican American people to understand that to be Mexican American more often than not is to be indigenous, but is to be so displaced from your specific indigenous origin that sometimes people literally forget and have to be reminded. And so it's just like, to me, this is an incredible intervention into these gaps in the curriculum. Okay. So I could probably go on about Lucy Cruz forever because I love her and I love that archive, but pulling us back to this, to me, what's really remarkable about this is she shared her own knowledge and research in unique, free, or low-cost formats. She used her materials to fill in the gaps in the curriculum and uphold her community. She always maintained autonomy and creative control over what she was doing, and she got creative with copyright concerns. That to me sounds like open. That's the way I do open. And so I appreciate acknowledging someone like Lucy as a person who was practicing many of these concepts that we're now realizing are so integral to the theory and praxis of our discipline. I also just wanted to take a few moments to sort of compare this to Kayla Larson's The Indigenous Six R's. She talks about respect, relationships, responsibility, reverence, relevance, and reciprocity. And I think we see a similar vein both in those protocols that I showed you and also in the work that Dr. Lucy Cruz did with her museum. So for me, this is sort of a beautiful connection where I can see, yes, the Indigenous Six R's apply to both contemporary ways of thinking about Indigenous knowledge keeping and also the way Indigenous people like Dr. Lucy Cruz Gajcek have been making and keeping our own histories since time immemorial and often in a hostile environment. My key takeaways for us today are open as a movement starts much earlier than the typically given history and includes the intellectual and labor contributions of BIPOC people right from the start. This is just one example of an early open innovator, Dr. Lucy Cruz, and her unique approach to filling in the gaps. Broader open ontologies help to expand our open movement and also help to reconnect us to our radical education roots. So with that in mind, thank you so much for your time and attention. Thanks for being here. This is a really special presentation for me to be able to combine what's been an 11-year journey with Chicana Par Madrasa with this more recent role as Open Education Librarian. If you're interested to learn more, this is all going to be in greater detail in this forthcoming chapter in Indigenous Knowledges and Open Education. That's by Athabasca University Press, and it should be coming out as an open text next year. So with that, I'm going to stop my share and open us up for questions and conversation.
That was a great presentation. Thank you so much, Marco. So I think we can start off by just having folks unmute their mics if they have questions or anything that they would like to offer to the conversation.
Will the Q&A be recorded? And if people would prefer that it not, we could not record part of it.
Yeah, we could certainly do that. Can stop the recording.